with us this morning, we have two ends of the spectrum. We have Wayne Marquis, who's sort of the dean of the municipal leaders in the North Shore, Town Manager Danvers. Newest mayor in the area joining us from Beverly, Michael Cahill, elected just yesterday. Great. And now our speaker. Having been recently re-elected to his ninth term representing Massachusetts 6th District, nine terms, that's quite an accomplishment, John. U.S. Representative John Tierney has developed a national reputation as an effective legislator fighting for families, seniors, and small businesses. The Congress remains the only member from Massachusetts serving on the Committee on Education and Workforce, serving on the Subcommittee on Higher Education, Workforce Training, Subcommittee on Health, Employment, Labor, and Pensions for the 113th Congress. Fighting for a vibrant middle class and working to create opportunity for all, Congressman Tierney has been an active leader on education and labor issues. His hard work and commitment to ensuring the legislative branch conducts vigorous oversights have earned Congressman Tierney the chairmanship of the National Security and Foreign Affairs Subcommittee on the Committee of Oversight of Government Reform from 2007 to 2010. Chairman Tierney undertook a variety of investigations to ensure that the United States policy utilizes all aspects of our national power and maximizes our long-term national security interests, and that taxpayers' money is not being wasted and that we leave our children and grandchildren in a safer place to live. Born in Salem, Massachusetts, Congressman Tierney attended Salem Public Schools, graduated from Salem State University, earned a law degree from Suffolk University, and until he took office in 1997, was a partner of a local law firm in Salem, Tierney, Kalis, and Lucas for over 20 years. He and his wife, Patrice, continue to make their home in Salem. Please join me in a warm welcome for John Tierney.
Thank you, Ralph. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for that introduction, and always good to see you. And I know you're winding up your term, and I think you've done a great job, and I'm sure evidence of that is the large number of people that are now members and joining there, your work and Bob's, of course, and the staff on that, so congratulations for a great term. So welcome, everybody. I don't come here often. I did come here once to play golf. I was on the fairway almost every hole. Of course, it was a bank shot of somebody's condo, but it's still the fairway, the way I look at it on that, but I was never invited back for a second round, I can tell you that. Now I'm very pleased, Mike Cahill, congratulations on a race well run. Forward to working with your office and the folks that you bring in with you on that. I was going to make some comments about Bill Tinty and give him a little needle, but he's not here, at least not here yet on that. But Bill's been doing great work, and I'm thrilled to see that he's going to take his second cycle through as chairman of the board here on that basis. When was the last time, Bob?
1993.
So he's had a little time off, time to get back. But Bill doesn't take a lot of time off. In fact, he most recently got through working with the Workforce Investment Board, being on the statewide, chairman of the statewide Workforce Investment Board, as well as the local and regional board. And in that sense, was a great asset for me as we drafted the Workforce Investment Act. I had the honor of putting that bill together, which was a bipartisan piece of work that dealt with and deals with the idea of how we're going to get people the skill set and the educational level they need to take the jobs of today and the jobs of the future. And it really talks about pulling together industry people, as well as our community colleges and colleges, other non-for-profits, and people that can direct and get people what they need in order to take a job that really is going to pay decently and service the needs that we have in our district. So region by region in each state, determine what are the needs, what industries are really growing and going to grow, and how do we get people ready to do that. We got great advice from Mary Saris, who runs the North Shore Center, as well as from Bill, and a lot of that's reflected in our legislation that we hope will move forward. More on that later, and whether or not things are going to be moving forward at all. But Bob, thank you, and thank Bob also for pulling together a group of folks who came down to talk about the Affordable Care Act and its impact on small business. I'm quite aware of the concerns that the community has, and it was an opportunity to get Bob, AIM, and a number of different members of both organizations down in Washington with Undersecretary Hash to talk about the concerns. I know the governor wrote a letter asking for waivers, and then the legislature asked him to write the letter again, and he did. We've also wrote a letter that I headed up, but I know several of my colleagues joined. We've not had success on that yet. We are told that several of the issues are matters of interpretation, that we ought not to worry. We're still trying to nail down just why we shouldn't have to worry on that, but we think we may be all right on some of the issues. The others, we're meeting some reservations from the secretary on that. We want to keep working with that. I did meet with Dennis, president's secretary and chief of staff the other day.
Thank you for hosting that meeting.
No, you're welcome, hey Bob, on that. But I mean, those are things we have to keep working on or whatever. Massachusetts is the pioneer of healthcare. We ought to get some credit for that and some understanding of the work that we've done and what's working on here. And that's what we're looking for with those waivers. So thank you for that. And just Dick Moody, thank you for the work that you do, not only with the operation support for our troops, but Dick is a member of our advisory committee on veterans for the office on that. It helps us with a number of things, such as the November 14th job fair that we're having. You know, we have too many veterans that are out of work right now. That's just one of the issues, but he's been a great member and leader on that. And then I won't go through the entire head table here, but Mrs. Joanne Patton, it's an honor to share the head table with you. This occasion, I missed regretfully the event they had honoring you very recently, but I understood that they had to change the venue because there were so many people that wanted to be and participate in that. I have read Benjamin's book on Growing Up Patton, which he pays a great tribute to all the Pattons and to you in particular on that. So thank you for your service to military families and for all that you do for the community. So Bob asked me to come here today and give an update, as if most of you don't know what's going on or not going on down in the United States House of Representatives at this point in time. And so in phrasing it and talking about it, it's hard not to sound critical of some of my colleagues, which then people will interpret as being partisan, and we go down that path on that. But I want to be frank with you, and I want to tell you what's going on, and you can then measure that any way you want about what biases or opinions I may bring to the table. But the fact of the matter is that you all know and understand, and I think the public asserts it more than anybody, we have to find a way for people to work with those with whom they disagree. You know, everybody has their principles. Not every single matter is a principle, but the way that some people are acting down in Washington is as if everything is that can't be compromised. Compromise is a dirty word, and therefore they just won't change their position in any way at all. We have to get back to that part of governance which says that we all have principles and none of us are going to forfeit them, but we are going to find a way, if it's an innovative or a new way or some way, to work with others that we disagree with and move forward. That's been the history of this country. It's the expectation of the population of this country that we do that. Now, in the current structure, you know, John Boehner is the Speaker of the House and he has 235 Republicans and a sizable majority. He sort of honed to the fact that Denny Hastert, when he was the Speaker, said he wouldn't move bills forward unless a majority of his conference agreed with him. Well, that's probably a formula for keeping and retaining your speakership. But when you have the situation that we have today with such a core of people who really don't believe in governance at all, it's not much of a formula for getting things done. We've had some examples where we've managed to get some things done. The Violence Against Women's Act. We stopped from going over the fiscal cliff last January. We did manage to get some relief out for Sandy, and more recently we did end up putting people back to work and stopping the shutdown that was there. But the one thing that all of those had in common was that the Speaker had to reach across the aisle and find some people that would work with some people on his side and pass the bill. And he did not get a majority of his conference. But the fact of the matter is America's business was done, and all of those bills were imperfect. Every bill's imperfect. And I didn't agree with all of those bills and everything in them. But that's the way governance works. You try to find some way that you get a majority and do those things that have to get done, and that's how those particular matters get done. There are, by varying estimates, some 40 to 80 people in John Boehner's conference that call themselves any variety of names, most prominent with the Young Guns, read by Paul Ryan and McCarthy from California and some others. They're pretty enamored with their approach to governance. They've written a book they entitled The Young Guns after themselves. There's no shortage of self-esteem, as you can tell on that. But the premise of the book, if you read it, and that's why we shouldn't be surprised when governance shuts down, the whole premise of the book is that they will not compromise. So why was the media, why were others at all surprised when they held their ground and didn't budge on that? And why was John Boehner surprised, and why did he understand that he had to seek out a larger majority to move forward? Those are the questions we ought to have. But in the end, when government was reopened, I note there's still 144 people voted against reopening the government. So 144 people were fine with the idea of government continuing to be shut down and all of the problems that that created, and apparently, because it was staying with part of the same package, they were fine with defaulting on the full faith and credit of the United States government. Now, some of them indicated that they didn't think the shutting down of the government was a problem because people would learn how to live with less government, but then they immediately took to the floor to try to open up department by department, all of those things that they were getting criticized for shutting down. whether it was the Park Services or the National Institute of Health, right on down the line.